A new report in USA Today examines what could be a massive vulnerability in our national security: travel by train and subway. Let's take a look at the numbers for you. Every day, 15 million people board trains and subways without being screened by security across the country. That's a conservative estimate. While there has been controversy over ramped up security measures on planes, there are just 700 million airline passengers a year compared to 4 billion rail travelers. And when you look at spending, since September 11th, $30 billion has been allocated for airline security over about a course of 10 years. Comparatively, just $1.7 billion has been for subways, cargo and passenger rails, buses and ferries. Roger Cressy is an NBC terrorism analyst and the president of Good Harbor Consulting. Roger, thanks for joining us today. How serious of a problem is this?
Well, Richard, it's a serious problem, but it's one that's not going to be solved anytime soon because the traditional security procedures that we can deploy simply don't make sense with the type of economic model necessary for the subways and for rail. Well, instead of looking at it from the aviation security perspective, we're going to have to look at it from a different perspective, which is you're never going to have universal screening. Mm-hmm. You're never going to have those type of layers. Instead, you're going to have a random-based approach that may detect problems, but is never going to guarantee that high level of confidence we see in other transportation sectors.
How effective are those random-based screenings? Has there been studies on them?
Well, they have, and random-based screenings are a form of deterrence. The whole idea is to create a public level of scrutiny, a public level of security that potentially deters others mm-hmm. from wanting to bring something in for fear they might get caught. But the sheer randomness of it alone is a great vulnerability if a determined terrorist wants to go through it. So instead, what you got to think of is that it's not security measures as much as it is good intelligence and being able to identify these people well before they get to the train station or the subway station.
So, Roger, if a municipality comes to you, comes to Good Harbor Consulting and says, we are looking for a solution, what would you suggest to them other than this random-based screening that they may be able to employ?
And by the way, they're going to ask for a solution in a budget-constrained environment because
right.
nobody has money right now for these things. It's several things. It's a layered approach of deploying people for a random screening, deploying available technologies to better determine whether there are anomalies, and also it's a public awareness campaign. Amtrak has had a see something, say something. New York has deployed that for a number of years, mm-hmm. and it's that type of passenger vigilance that's going to be important. But it's also just realizing, Richard, we accept the level of risk in our mass transportation regarding threats such as terrorism. That's never going to go away, and it's one we just have to be comfortable with and manage it appropriately.
And one of the challenges for experts like you, as well as these municipalities, are between those train stations, between those stops, even though you may be screening them there, there's a space in between where attacks could happen, right?
Absolutely. The intermodal nature of mass transit creates all sorts of opportunities for an adversary. And you also have a lot of trains and their cars being housed in areas that are not secure at all. It's not like an airport where a plane overnight stays in a secure location on the airport grounds. So the sheer volume of potential vulnerabilities is so high that some of the traditional security procedures simply don't apply. That's why we have to be creative, and that's why security at the stations is the last line of defense. The first line is identifying these people before they ever get near the potential target.
Yeah, and most of the resources that we were just talking about here, Roger, have been going for airline flights and security with regard to passengers. But there's also cargo flights that fly over the United States. Is that a major vulnerability as well?
Well, we saw the air cargo plot that came out of Yemen 2 months ago, and you've seen more attention to cargo screening as a result. For some time, there was a priority to try and get 100% screening of cargo. That's not going to happen either because all the cargo coming from international airports, simply they don't have the same level of security procedures there. So, again, you have to identify the most at-risk locations, improve the security at those locations, and hopefully that will get us the level of security that is at least manageable and acceptable.
Yeah, because cargo is not screened that flies over the United States. That's got to worry some, no doubt. Roger Cressy, thanks a lot.
Yeah.